shame. The King of Love has come to save. So we will dance and celebrate. The King of Love has come to reign, and we are free from all our shame. The King of Love has come to save. So we will dance and celebrate. The King of Love has come to reign, and we are free from all our shame. The King of Love has come to save. So we will dance and celebrate. The mighty King of Love, your name is higher, higher than any other.
Hallelujah.
My overcomer and the lover of my soul.
Yes, you are.
Your love is greater, greater than any failure. 'Cause you are the maker and the savior of my soul. The mighty King of Love.
Bless the Lord. If you're thankful for the love of Christ, give him a shout of praise this morning. Hallelujah, Jesus. Ah, we bless your holy name. Praise the Lamb of God, who is worthy this morning of your praise. Praise the Lamb, praise the Lamb. We worship you today, Father. Come on, let's just worship the Lord today. Just thank him right there where you're at. I want you to just think of something right now that you're blessed. And you're just thankful for Christ this morning. If it's just for salvation, tell him, thank you, Jesus, that you've saved my soul. Thank you, Jesus, for my family. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, just right now, all over this place, just thank him right now. Come on, thank him right now. Find something. Think about something you're thankful for. It's because of Christ you're here today. Hallelujah. What a good God we serve. We serve you, Jesus. What a worthy God. What a holy God. What a just God. What a saving God. Hallelujah.
Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to
Sing.
Jesus today. We adore you, Jesus, today. Come on, all over this house, just love on him today. We bless your name this day. Oh, we thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for your grace today. Oh, what an awesome God you are. What a strong and mighty God you are. You're a healing God. Hallelujah. You're a delivering God. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. We worship you. We worship you today. Oh, come, let us adore you. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord, for you
come to worship the Lord today. Just sing that. Sing that. Just everybody sing. Just lift him up. Just lift him up. Exalt him. I'm going to teach you one of the ways how. And really, it's in a way that maybe you wouldn't think in just a little while. And this is going to be an interesting service. I know it is. God spoke to me last week. And so I just felt like the Lord said this Sunday is the first Sunday of December. And how many know this is the time of year we celebrate the greatest gift that was ever given, of course, to this earth. And that's Christ. Amen. And the angels did say to the shepherds, you'll find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And we celebrate the greatest gift ever given, but I felt like God said, I just want to give us some gifts today. And I'm going to pray in just a moment, and then we're going to go on with what we're going to do. But I'd like for you to do this for me in your mind. Matter of fact, I might even just have you pray it or say it. I might just have you say it. The psalmist, and it fails me in my mind where it's at exactly. I preached it many years ago, but I don't exactly remember what verse it is, but I know it's in there. They say the older you get, the more that happens. You know, every time I hear now Elder Shannon and Dr. Crook say anything, they just say the Bible somewhere. I'm just teasing. They know it better than I do. But I know it's in there. It talks of not limiting the Holy One of Israel. And I want you to imagine with me for just a moment, if we truly believe that he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ask or think. And we could take the limits off. Religion will always try to make you limit God to man's thinking. I want you to take the limits off of God. Because God is more than able and willing to do far exceeding above anything we could ask or think. Dream it up, and God says, you ask it, and I'll make that dream even bigger. Just say this with me. Say, God is a big God. I need to ask big. Amen? Well, praise the Lord. Give the Lord a shout of praise. That's your prayer. That's a little different. Well, glory. Well, glory. I don't know what key you're in. We're going to pray, aren't we? Yes, come stay right here. Can I get some elders together around? We're going to pray for Ray. You're good. They're part of our church, and he's been taken to the hospital. He's got strep, a real bad case of infection. And God, we're just going to believe. The first thing we're going to ask God to do today is heal him. Can you believe that with me? Amen. Amen. Gather around. And let's pray. Father, I thank you and I praise you that you hear and answer prayer. We come, God, bringing Ray to you, who's in the hospital right now. I pray that you'll go to where he is. Span the miles and the space that's between us. We cannot touch him, but you can. And I pray, God, that the Holy Spirit would so envelop him. We ask, God, that you would give him the gift right now. Heal him in his body. Touch him, God. Raise him up off of this bed of affliction and glorify yourself in this situation. We believe it, God. We anoint with the oil of the Spirit, believing, God, that you are healing him in his body. We receive it now by the stripes of Christ. In Jesus' name, let God's people say amen. Amen. Praise God. Yeah, go ahead and give the Lord a praise. That's all right. Your blessing's coming through. Your blessing's coming through. My God is pouring out a blessing you won't have room to receive. Your blessing's coming through. How many believe it this morning? Well, your blessing's coming through. Your blessing's coming through. My God is pouring out a blessing you won't have room to receive. Your blessing's coming through. The answer, your answer's coming through. Your answer's coming through. My God is pouring out a blessing you won't have room to receive. Your blessing's coming through. Well, praise the Lord. If you believe it. Can we gather around? Her daughter's having some complications. She's pregnant and lost the baby. And with the possible problems, it could be that she would never be able to have a baby. How many know that God's able to heal her right now, touch her? That she can obey the word of the Lord, and that is replenish the earth.
Hallelujah.
Father, I thank you and I praise you that you hear and answer prayer. We come right now, God, bringing this little girl to you. Touch her womb and the tubes and all the stuff that's involved. God, bring healing. You saw in your sovereign will to see fit to take this baby, but God, I pray that you'll protect the womb for the next one you want to bring into this earth. Do it now, Jesus, by your stripes. Oh, hallelujah. I feel the anointing right there. I believe it's done in Jesus' name. I believe it's done in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. I feel an anointing right there, don't you? Praise God. Praise God. Well, praise the Lord. You may be seated. So thankful for each of you that are here. And each one that's online, would you welcome our online congregation? Thank God for them. I'll let the singers go. And ushers, will you get in place? We're going to receive the gifts that we're going to bring him today. You cannot pay for nor buy the blessing of God, but you absolutely can obey God in his word. And he promises if we bring the tithe and offering to him, that he'll open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings upon us. Amen. And I want you to hear that. Let me teach you something. I'm going to talk a little more about this. This is just kind of, just as something's on my heart, I'm just going to share it today. I want you to listen to me. Almost everything God asks us to do or be a part of in his word, it pushes us toward humility. Everyone say humility. Humility. The whole thing of giving and receiving is God pushing us towards humility. Jesus said, "Given it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over." How many like those sounds right there? I like that. I want to tell you something. I like that. The only thing I've, ever had running over in my life's trash. I'll take some of the other stuff. And you know, that could be proverbial too. Some of us had a lot of trash running over. Have you ever done that with a trash bag? You press it in and put more? You know what I'm talking about? But he said, blessing will be running over. But listen to what he said. Given it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men pour into your bosom. Personally, I like the idea of it just showing up in my bank account accidentally. It'd be better if it just showed up in the mailbox and I didn't have to worry about it. But he said, shall men pour into your bosom. Now, why did God say a lot of the blessing we receive would come through men? You want to know why? Because it's very humbling to receive something from someone you're looking at. It's very humbling to receive. And so God says, I'm going to force the issue of humility. If you're not willing to receive from people, you're not going to be blessed. Given it shall be given unto you. And then people say, well, I give, but I have no expectation of receiving. Guess what? You'll get exactly what you're believing for. You know why? Because that goes directly contradictory to God's word. Jesus said, give and it shall be given unto you. In other words, he said, you ought to give, and then you ought to expect me to bless you when you do. That's what he said. Say amen.
Amen.
So anything other than expecting blessing from God, anything other than expecting him to pour out blessing upon us, would be contradiction to what Jesus said. Now, I'll be honest with you. I'll take what Jesus said over what your ideas are any day of the week. Amen. So, if you have your offering, get it ready. Father, I pray that you'll bless this and multiply it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. I want to read. I'm going to use this again in a minute. Doesn't that look good? It's a nice looking mic. Had that mic for a long time. That is an expensive mic. The more you pay for a mic, the better it makes you sound. Now, actually, can I be honest with you? The more you pay for a mic, the more clear how bad you sound is.
Pastor.
Yes, sister. We're glad to have you, honey.
But this is my third Sunday, me and my sister.
Yes.
And I have been extremely blessed this year. I have low income, but I have had $2,000 between my sisters helping me. And my daughter. I've had broken glasses, broken dentures, both hearing aids quit, and I had no money.
Yeah.
And they all helped, and my older sister just this week paid $600 for me to be able to pay for my first 2 months of health.
Isn't that wonderful? Bless your heart, honey. And she's got glasses and teeth. You know what that means? That means you're able to see what you're eating. I won't tell you, there's been some stuff set in front of me that I didn't want to see what I was going to eat.
And it's very hard for me to take because I've never had to do that.
Well,
but since my husband's been gone, it's been rough. I lost all of his income.
Sure. But that's what God teaches us. He teaches us to humbly receive. Let's bless the Lord for our sister. We're glad to have you, girls. I want to read here in Matthew chapter 7, some verses of Scripture. You can just stay right where you are. It's a little different today. I don't really feel, unless it changes, this strong preach on me. I can always preach, but I always want to do what the Lord wants me to do. So Matthew chapter 7, listen to what Jesus said. Ask and it shall be given you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. Or what man is there of you, whom if his son ask bread, will give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? Now listen to these words. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more? Underline that. How much more? Say that with me. How much more shall your Father which is in heaven give good things to them that ask him? Now listen to that. Now another place, I believe it's in Luke, that it says how much more will he give the Holy Ghost to them that ask. But here, Matthew tells us how much more will he give good things to him that asks. Do you understand one of the most honorable things we can do is ask God to bless us? Now that runs contrary to the flesh, but I want you to hear me now in rational thinking. But I've heard people say this, well, I really don't ask for myself, I just ask for others. Well, that's just pride inverted. That's not godly. No, Jabez was, the Bible says, found great honor with God. And when he found great honor with God, he did it by just saying, God, will you bless me? And then he said, look, I'm looking at my property and I wish my fence line were over there. Would you push back the fences? Give me more. Give me more, he said. Now listen to that. And it says God was honored by that. Now, before I go any farther, I'm not going to, just because I like doing this, because I'm a preacher and I'm an outliner, and I enjoy my outlines and the alliteration and all the rest of it, and to show you how good I am at reading a thesaurus. For ask, I wrote down three things, and I'm going to talk about it all in one or two paragraphs here. We see here the extent of contrition, the expression of confidence, expectancy of certainty. Isn't that good? Don't that just sound good, Norma? It didn't, did it? I thought it sounded great. But I want you to get this now. Why is God so honored by us asking? I'm going to tell you why. God's honored by our asking because asking is one of the truest and highest forms of humility. Now, let me say that again. Asking is one of the truest and highest forms of humility. Now, why would you say that, Troy? I say that because when you ask, the act of asking itself is an admission on your part that you cannot bring to you the thing that you're asking for. I don't have the ability. I don't have the wherewithal. I don't have the strength. I cannot do the thing that I'm asking. And so when we go to God and ask him for anything, what we are saying by the simple act of asking is, God, I will not be this and I will not have this unless you give it to me. That's honoring to God. Asking is an expression. It's an extent of humility. It shows God that I can't do this myself. I've got to have you do it. I'm not even going to take time to talk about seeking and knocking. That's a whole other sermon. We're just going to talk about asking in a minute. Because what I want to do today is I want your faith to swell in such a place that you can, that you feel free to ask God for anything. Now, of course, it's biblically based. And, you know, you don't ask God to kill your wife or husband or nothing like that. Some of you may have asked that. Oh, I'm having fun. I don't know about anybody else. I'm having a great time. It's humility in action. Asking is important because it shows that we're putting confidence in the one we're asking. Amen. Do you know anybody that you just don't really bother asking them anything?
In fact, there are certain people that you've asked about certain things or whatever it may be, and you've asked them 1,000 times and nothing came to fruition. And at that point, you're just like, you know what, I'm not going to bother asking them anymore. What are you saying? Their character is as such, I know they're not good for anything that I'm asking. But when we ask God, what we're saying is, God, we've got confidence in your character. Remember what he said to James when he said that we're to ask in faith? He said, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God who giveth freely and abradeth not. In other words, God doesn't even scold you when you ask him for something. He don't even abrade you. He don't beat you down. He said, but ask in faith. Now listen to that. He said, ask in faith, because no man receives anything when his faith is like the wave of a sea. Now what was he teaching us? Put confidence in the one you're asking. Now you can stand on his word and say, God, I'm going to ask this because this is what you said. Now I got to tell you this morning, before I go any farther, I am, mark it down, understand it, it's the absolute truth, I am the number one chocolate milk maker in the whole world. That's the truth. Tom, there's nobody can make chocolate milk better than me. Do you know why I'm the number one chocolate milk maker in the world? Because I don't skimp on the quick. I don't hold back. I'm not talking one scoop. I'm not even talking two scoops. At least 3 scoops. Yes, number one chocolate milk maker. All of my children from the time now, Bella and Bailey, they don't even bother asking anybody else to make chocolate milk. They ask me to make chocolate milk. Middle of the night, Bella be like, Daddy, I want some chocolate milk. You see, you put yourself in a precarious situation when you're the number one chocolate milk maker. Because they don't bother asking anybody else. Used to, she'd wake up Mandy, but now it's Daddy. I remember when Katie was little, 2, 3 years old, right around that age. I got home and just all the time, Daddy, will you make me some chocolate milk? Daddy, will you make me chocolate milk? Daddy. And one evening, I said, Baby, I'll make you some chocolate milk in a little bit. Just let me sit down a minute. I just got home. I promise I'll make you some chocolate milk. Well, a little bit went by. A little bit more went by. And Katie said, Daddy, will you make me some chocolate milk? And I said, now, Katie, just a minute. I said, and she, now listen, the audacity of this 3-year-old, the backbone, Dr. Crooks, she squares her shoulders and stuck out her chest and looked me in the eye and pointed her little finger at me. And she said, Daddy, you said you would make me chocolate milk. You know what I did? I got up off the couch. I made some chocolate milk. Why did Katie have the confidence to square her shoulders and point at me and say, Daddy, you said you would make chocolate? Where did she get the confidence to do that? You know where? From me. Why? Because I try my best. I do my best. I fail, but I do my best to keep my word with my children. If I say I'm going to get them something, I do my best to get it, unless I can't, and then I apologize for it. If I say they're going to be in trouble, then I have to follow through and ground them, or I can't count to 5 or 10 or give them another 5 more seconds. No, I need to follow through. If I say they're going to get a whooping, turn the cameras off. I know you're not allowed to do that today. But if I say they're going to get a whooping, then bless God, you better give them a whooping. Whenever you tell your children that you're going to do something or give them something or whatever it may be, and then you don't do it, they start to lose confidence in your character. I'm preaching right now. If you do that again, I'll do such and such, and then you don't do such and such, and then they think in their little mind, Daddy's a liar. Amen, preacher. I try not to lie to my kids. If I say it, I try to back it up. And Katie, at 3 years old, here I am preaching now, Katie, at 3 years old, knew that about me. She had the confidence to remind me of my, I'm preaching so good, right? To remind me of my character. God can be reminded of his character. We can have confidence. In fact, the Hebrew writer said we can even go before him with boldness because of Christ and stand before him and say, God, you said. Are you still in the building? All right. You know, the Bible says you have not because you ask not. You don't have it because you haven't asked for it. I was thinking there the other day, Bella has no problem with that right now. Little Bella, she, every single day, I hear her Christmas list. I'm not kidding you. I mean, Chris, every day, and it gets bigger every day, and everything she wants is expensive. It's like she's physically related to Mandy. I mean... thought I'd throw that out there. Her list, I said, everything she sees, everything she hears about, I want that for Christmas. I want this for Christmas. I want this, and she knows them all. She adds to the list, but she remembers every single thing I want for Christmas. I said to Bella the other day, I said, Bella, do you realize when Santa Claus gets your list, he's going to retire? There are elves right now on ventilator machines just trying to breathe because of your list. Not the list of all the kids in the world, your list. She has no problem asking. He says, you have not because you ask not. Now, here's what I want to get to. He gives us examples as to why we should ask and why we should believe that he'll do it. He gives us example. He brings it right down to home. He said, if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more? I was thinking about this and thought about two things. You know, I grew up, didn't have much. We were not well-to-do, to say the least. Daddy worked hard, passed away when I was 13, raised 7 kids. You know, every time I eat with someone, they said, man, you eat fast. I said, when you grew up the baby of 7, and you're poor, you eat fast or you don't get nothing. I can still remember arguing who was going to get the piece of beef in the vegetable soup. We would fight for the beef that was in it. It was very limited. It was always that wonderful day that you got the ladle and the beef ended up in your bowl. My kids think I'm being dramatic. No, this is the truth. I can still remember one day, I'm the youngest, and I got the beef in my ladle. Put it in my bowl, and my brother Tim took his and frogged me. Knocked me clear to the ground and took my bowl with the beef in it and walked in the other room. I laid there in pain and thought to myself, I'm going to grow up one of these days, buddy. You think I'm telling a lie? I'm telling you the truth. That's one of the reasons why roast beef is one of my favorite dinners every week. What do you want to eat? Nancy will ask. Or Mandy, what do you want to eat? I'll have roast beef. I still remember laying in a pool of my own blood. With the piece of beef that I had in my bowl. told you this is going to be different today. We didn't have a whole lot. I thought about this. If we, being evil, know how to give good things to our children. I thought about my daddy. He was a World War II vet. He was a strong, tough man. But in my little memory, there are two things that he'd done in the way of giving to me that I wouldn't trade for $1 million check. One, when I was about 9 or 10 years old, we were going to church camp. And at Nipshin, they always had, at the church camp, they always had a little snack bar you could buy stuff, and they had a little bookstore you could buy trinkets and things. And they'd always try to give me $5 for spending money. The church paid to go to camp, and I'd get $5 from Dad. Well, this one year, he didn't have $5. He didn't have it. And I was so heartbroken. He said, well, son, go see if you can find something to do to make some money. There was a guy that had a big farm right there close to where we lived. He had farms all over Kentucky and all over Ohio. Had about 20 or 25 farms, very wealthy man. And I went over to him. He happened to be over there, and I went over to him and said, is there something, I'm 9 or 10 years old, something I could do to earn $5? And he said, I lost a grease gun out here in this field somewhere. If you find it, I'll pay you $5. Children, I look for that grease gun all day long. I uncovered every blade of grass, the hot blazing sun upon my brow. I searched, went home, got something to eat for lunch. Dad said, did you find it? I said, didn't find it. He said, keep looking, boy. You're going to earn $5. You'll have to spend the money for camp. And I looked and I looked and I looked and looked and looked and never did find anything. Brokenhearted, shoulders drooped, saddened face. And I looked up at that wealthy farmer and said, I couldn't find it. And he said, well, he didn't give me no money either. And that was the deal. I didn't expect him to give me $5. The deal was, I find the grease gun, I get $5. I didn't find it. And I went home brokenhearted. I didn't have no money for camp. Can't imagine these days. I'm a daddy now. I'm a daddy now, and I've never been in that position that my dad was in. I can't imagine how he must have felt. Wanting to give me the $5, but didn't have it. When I went to get in the car to go to camp, to meet at the church, and we were going to ride in the bus to go to camp, my daddy came out, Chris. He said, son, give me your hand. I opened my little hand. Dad had about 75, 80 cents. And he poured it in my hand and closed it. He said, it's all I've got. And it's yours. That's it. That's all I've got. You can have it, son. It wasn't $5. And it didn't do much for me then, but I want to tell you something as I look back on that 80 cents or whatever it was. I wouldn't trade it for anything. But my dad was an evil man, just like you are. There's nothing righteous about us. And if my dad, who was by nature evil, could walk over there, Elder Shannon, to the car and pour 75 or 80 cents in my hand and close my hand and say, I love you so much, I'll give you everything I've got. How much more? Why do we limit him? How much more? How much more will our Heavenly Father give good things? And then the other story I want to tell you, and then we're going to move on. Alex got in trouble about this guitar. First thing I learned to play was guitar. My first guitar I ever had, my brother Tim got me his little learner guitar, and it wasn't much. My brother Melvin showed me the chord G, and I learned, memorized that chord and tuned the guitar from remembering the chord G. I was about 10 years old. By the time I was 11, my daddy had saved up some money. And my brother Melvin had this guitar right here, a little Alvarez Regent. Melvin said to Dad, I want to sell it. Dad said, boy, Troy's learning to play guitar, some chords. I said, what do you want for it? Melvin said, I need to have $75 for it. That's true. Back in 82, in our situation, $75 was an awful lot of money. But my dad scrimped and he saved and he scrimped and he saved and he scrimped and he saved. He said, you hold on to that guitar, Melvin. I'm buying that for Troy. Just know how to reach it. It's not much of a guitar, it's okay. Where I'm at in life today, I could go out and buy any guitar almost. If not, I'd just ask my buddy Jerry to buy it for me. I'll receive an extra offering at the church. I'm only teasing. I wouldn't do that. But my dad saved up $75 and bought me this guitar. I've had it for 33 years. I wouldn't take anything for it. I was thinking about this service. I pulled this guitar out and the string was broke. I said, Alex. He bowed his head. I said, son, I told you to leave this alone. Don't play with this one. This is not a toy. First thing I ever learned to play was a guitar. I was going to play this one this morning. I pulled it out and didn't have time to fool with it. But I thought about all these memories of my daddy. If you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more? I thought about that guitar he bought me. I borrowed one. I'm going to sing a song. It's just stuff that's on my mind. And since it's the church that I pastor, I get to do what I want to do. And I very rarely play guitar anymore. I don't know how good this will come out. But I thought about my evil daddy.
Saved up money and bought me this guitar for $75. First song I ever played and sang. It was 2 years before my daddy died. In church, first song I ever played, a few years before he died, was on guitar. My daddy sat in the back of the room. It was... No, it wasn't that. It was Tears. It was in church. I hear the train of... No, I didn't do that. It wasn't Johnny Cash. Today I started. No, it wasn't that either. It wasn't Merle Haggard. Had I done that in church, like I'm doing right now? In fact, my mama right now is coming out of the grave after. Oh, yes. Had I even attempted to do such a thing? Be in a grave. The first song I ever played and sang, my guitar, the gift of my daddy. Once I was clothed in the rags of my sin, wretched and poor, lost and lonely, but with Let me button this all up and tie it together now. The reason why I brought that guitar and talked about my evil daddy wanting to give things to me is the first thing I sang with it is I'm a child.
Yeah.
Thank the Lord.
I'm a child of the King. I got the last name Ervin, but I've also got some different blood thrown through my veins.
Hallelujah.
I'm his child. That's why at any moment I can knock on the door or in the middle of the night, just like Bella, who without hesitation comes in and wakes me out of my sleep saying, Daddy, Daddy, I sure want some chocolate milk. At any moment, Paul said, I can cry, Abba, Father. Amen. Daddy,
hallelujah.
I need this.
Hallelujah.
Daddy, I want this. Daddy, will you bless me? He said, ask, and you shall receive. He said, and I'll prove it to you. If you, being evil, will give good gifts to your children, how much more a limitless, righteous, holy God will give good gifts to his children. And he's not some obscure, off in the distance God. No, he is our daddy. We are his children. So this is your service. A little different today, but here's what I want to do. This is your altar call. You can come forward, you can stand up where you are, you can sit where you are, but I want you to take a moment and I want you to ask him for a gift. Whatever's on your heart, don't limit it. Whatever comes to your mind and heart, if it's not against his word, if it's not against his character as God, I want you to ask it. I know what I'm going to ask him for. Without hesitation. And I believe he's going to give it. So, I hope this has been the right thing for you. It ain't done anything for anybody else, it helped me. But I'm going to set this guitar down. And I'm just going to go down and I'm going to ask God for something. If you want to ask him, you do the same. Thank you, Jesus. Just ask him. Without a moment's hesitation, just ask him. Daddy, what are you asking him for? And I want to say to you that are still sitting here, and maybe you got something you need to ask him or you're hesitant to ask, I want you to listen to me. If you say you have need of nothing, then I want you to know the Bible in Revelation says those are the ones that are worse off than anybody else. We all need, spiritually, physically, financially, whatever it may be. Someone says, can I ask God to bless me financially? Absolutely. You ask your boss for a raise, don't you? Nothing wrong. And listen to me, there's nothing wrong with this. There's nothing wrong with having this things in this world. What is wrong is if these things in this world have you. There have been times I've been real specific in asking. I remember you were asking specifically about a car. Remember that? I mean, right down to the model and type. And what are you driving? The model and type. There's nothing wrong with that. Honestly, and I don't know why I'm just, but honestly, and you tell me if I'm wrong. I believe when we don't ask God, it's an assault on his character. We're saying, I don't think you're the right kind of guy. In fact, we ought to ask God before we ask anybody else or anything else. Amen? Amen. Well, I didn't mean to ramble on so much. It's a little different, but I just believe God wants to give some Christmas presents out. I just believe what I've asked for, he's going to give it to me. He's going to give it to me. I believe that. Next week I'll be driving a Bugatti. I did not ask for that. Just so you know, I did not ask for that. Amen. Do you love Jesus? Amen. Are you glad you came to church today? I'm glad you did. Everybody stand with me. A couple more things on your way out. The usher is going to be handing you my Christmas list. Actually, it's Bella's list. I'm going to divide it up with the congregation. Santa Claus and I might have a shot if we all contribute. I'm teasing with you. Just look at your neighbor and say, I love you. Look at the person on the other side of him and say, I love you too. Now listen, before we go, hang on now, before we go, I want you to bow your heads. I wonder if there's someone today who would say, Pastor, I've come today, and I don't know that I'm one of his children. I don't know that I'm saved. I don't know that I'm one of God's children. But his voice is speaking to my heart. I don't know how to understand all that, but I feel God tugging at me. I don't know Christ as my Savior. Before we go, I wonder who would just raise your hand and say, I want to know God. I want to know God. Slip your hand up, anybody like that. I need him in my life. I see that hand. I need God. I need God in my life. Just slip your hand up. Anybody? Yes, I see that. No, anybody else? I need God in my life. And I believe, let me tell you something, he wants to be your father. He wants to be in your life more than you can even know. He'll adopt you in a second. Anybody else? Anybody else would say, I need God in my life. Slip your hand up. Anybody? Amen. Here's what we're going to do. If you want God in your life, we're going to ask right where you are. We're going to ask God to come into your heart. You ready? I just want you to pray this with me. Say, Heavenly Father. I believe you gave your son Jesus.
I believe you gave your son Jesus.
I believe he rose again from the dead.
I believe he rose again from the dead.
And I believe he's coming back.
And I believe he's coming back.
I ask you to forgive me of my sin.
I ask you to forgive me of my sin.
Come into my life.
Come into my life.
And I'll live with you.
And I'll live with you.
And for you.
And for you.
The rest of my life.
The rest of my life.
You're my Father.
You're my Father.
And I trust you.
And I trust you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. If you believe that and prayed it in your heart and believed it with all your heart, he is now a part of your life.
right now. Here's what I want you to do. Here's what I want you to do. Now, most of the time we give an altar call and people come forward. That's an open confession. That's an important thing. I like doing that. But if you don't come forward right now, I need you to openly confess it. Just tell somebody. Tell someone, hey, I got saved today. I accepted Christ today. It's always an open confession that he's looking for. You can't do it in secret. Huh? You can't do it in secret. He does everything in the open. And I ask you to do the same. All right? Have you appreciated what he's doing in your heart, in your life? Amen. Give the Lord a shout of praise one more time. A little different kind of service, but I believe it was the Lord. It's wonderful. He felt like the Lord said, "Those that what you do have, you're going to get a double portion of it." So I'll take that too. Amen. Amen. That's good. There's nothing wrong with that. And I just one last thing. If you really don't want blessing, go ahead and ask God. And if he gives it to you, just I'll take it. Pass it along. Whatever it may be, I'll take everything you got. So, Father, bless us as we go in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Love them one another. Good job, Pastor.